Welcome to Massey United Insurance's Line and Length. It's a cricket program where we look at the sport, not only in the region, but internationally as well. I'm Barry Wilkinson. Hello to all of our friends watching, especially on Digicel Sportsmax. From this edition, we are going to broadcast from the heart of Dominica. We are in Roseau for the first test match, West Indies versus Australia, being played right there at the lovely Windsor Park Stadium. Now, this test match has been met with some controversy. Many people here in Dominica believe that Shivnarine Chanderpaul still has a right to be in the team, and also that the opening batsman from Dominica, Theophile, should be there before Chandrika. We're going to talk to some Dominicans and get their perspective on what's happening in West Indies cricket. Also, we have some special guests, so stay tuned. You're watching Mass United Insurance's Line and Length from Dominica.
Across the Caribbean, more people are placing their trust in Massey United Insurance for the protection of the things that are important to them, their homes, businesses, and their prized possessions. That's because Massey United Insurance offers excellent general insurance coverage to help you manage whatever life sends your way. Our cadre of well-reputed agencies and trained insurance professionals are always ready to provide you with sound advice and prompt service. Choose the security and sound strength that is Massey United Insurance.
So welcome back then to Mass United Insurance's Line and Length. With me is Lockhart Sebastien. He has a lot of hats. He's not wearing any today, but generally. He is the manager for the Windward Islands cricket team, the Volcanoes, as they call themselves. And just recently, actually last Thursday, there was an incident where one of his players, Andre Fletcher, was unfortunately arrested for having ammunition in his bag. Lockhart Sebastien was thankfully there to assist. We're going to talk a bit about that, and we're also going to look at the Chanderpaul issue and Tyrone Theophile. Now, Lockhart, really good to have you, always on the show. What really happened last week with Andre Fletcher? Because it caught many by surprise.
Caught me by surprise, I can tell you, because when I got the call, I was a bit stunned because I didn't know he was even leaving the island, the state. He wasn't supposed to have left the state. But I think he got caught in that somebody presented him with some ammunition. He probably didn't know what it was because he had it in his hand like it was a normal thing. Then he put it in the carry-on. When he was stopped by security, he looked a bit surprised himself. And when the police came and they told him to live ammunition, he was arrested. And I can tell you, I do not think it was anything deliberate because Fletcher normally is a guy who plays the full, but I think he had the thing, thought it was just something casual because, as you know, he has a pellet gun home and he thought he was getting shots for the pellet gun. But it was live ammunition, 50 rounds. He was picked up. He was arrested, slept in the cell on the Thursday night, and we had to go to court on Friday. And he was fined 2,000 and then discharged.
Now, you know, as a manager, when you get news like that, what was your first reaction in terms of how can you get this solved? And then how did it all end? Because it seemed to finish pretty amicable.
Yes, well, I was shocked, I could tell you, because I...
Well, you weren't shocked, but shocked.
Yes, I was shell-shocked because I never knew he wasn't supposed to have left the state. But as I said, when it happened, we had to find a way to get it solved. And it was solved in the end. I mean, he got a slap on the wrist, I can tell you. Only been fined $2,000 for... You could go to prison for that. Yeah. I mean, I'm in your country, Bobby, probably would have gone to jail.
Yes. Yeah. Now, how's Andre doing? Has he rebounded from it?
Yes, I think he's okay. I've spoken to him many times ever since he's gone home. I mean, he's very apologetic. I mean, he's realized a mistake. I mean, nobody sensible knowing they would have that would be carrying that. It was an error of judgment. And I think the magistrate spoke to him. I mean, he must learn from that. And I'm sure he's going to learn from that. I don't expect him ever to do something, anything like that, because something like that can land you in prison.
All right. We're going to move on from that situation with Andre. Let's talk a little bit then now about the whole issue with Shivnarine Chanderpaul. I mean, walking the streets of Dominica, generally, it seems by and large, people are aggrieved that he was not dropped, but the manner it was done. Your personal thoughts, having played cricket for the Windward Islands and being a former professional cricketer?
If I was a selector, I would probably, not probably, I would surely have allowed Chanderpaul to finish the series against Australia. I mean, too many of our cricketers have gone out like that. You remember how Viv, when he retired, still wanted to play in the World Cup. They didn't select him. Desmond Haynes had to take the ball to cut Malcolm Marshall himself. So too many of our cricketers, and this is a guy who has served. Agreed, he hasn't done very well in the last six test matches, but we talk about youth. Too much youth is not good. In fact, we've seen what happened on the first day of the test match against Australia in Dominica. I mean, somebody like Shiv in the middle order, you expect him at some time to come good. And I thought it was an error to just have left him out like that. I think they should have allowed him, tell him, okay, after the test match in Jamaica, that's it. Hang up your boots.
So you're saying two counts. One, yes, you should have played. Two, you also thought that he was dismissed unceremoniously in the manner it was done.
Yes, I mean, the selectors have the job to do, don't get me wrong, and nobody has a divine right to be on any team, but I thought that Chanderpaul, the way, the service he has given West Indies cricket, I think he deserved a better way of going out of cricket, test cricket.
All right, now Tyrone Theophile, for those of you who don't particularly know him, he's an opening batsman, Dominican by birth, and plays for the Windward Islands, had a pretty prolific season for the last couple of years. Many thought this year was his turn to play and open the batting for the West Indies. It hasn't happened, and Dominicans are again aggrieved by that. Take the emotions out of it. Do you think he has a right or had a right to open in that first test in Dominica?
Well, as I said earlier, nobody has a right, but I think he's done well enough. In fact, if you look at the averages, Barry, in the top nine people, he's the only person who would not have played for West Indies this year. He averaged, your second year average, 689 runs, averaging 43, two centuries, three half centuries. I think he has deserved this chance, but I hope his chance comes at some point. West Indies are going to Sri Lanka late in the season. I expect him to be in the squad. He didn't get his chance. He didn't do very well in the President's 11 match. But I do not believe that should have been the yardstick to select a team. Because you see, like a lottery, here it is, you had a good season, and then one inning, like in Chandrika's case, one good inning and got selected. Chandrika has never made a test 100. As I say, I don't want to fault him. Sometimes people get their break and can go on. But I thought that was Tyrone's time to get selected.
Now, the crowd in Dominica has not been as dominant in terms of the big numbers you usually get. Granted, it was a Wednesday that the test match started. Was it a soft protest of because Theophile was not playing?
I don't think so. I think it's a Wednesday, as you know, Barry. Things are a bit tight now. Things tough now. Not only in Dominica, I think all around the place. So if the game would go on to Saturday and Sunday, you surely would see a packed house. But first day of the test match, we don't know. But Dominica, in fact, Barry, watch the crowd, is still by Caribbean standards a decent crowd, because a lot of countries you would not have gotten the crowd you had gotten on the first day of the test matches, albeit on Wednesday.
Right, wonderful stuff. So we've been talking to Lockhart Sebastien, manager of the Windward Islands cricket team here in Dominica. When we come back on the program, we're going to get the feel from some Dominicans about the Chanderpaul issue and much more. But first, you're watching Massey United Insurance's Line and Length.
Across the Caribbean, more people are placing their trust in Massey United Insurance for the protection of the things that are important to them, their homes, businesses, and their prized possessions. That's because Massey United Insurance offers excellent general insurance coverage to help you manage whatever life sends your way. Our cadre of well-reputed agencies and trained insurance professionals are always ready to provide you with sound advice and prompt service. Choose the security and sound strength that is Massey United Insurance.
So we're talking with Garvin Richards now. Garvin, first of all, how do you feel about Chanderpaul being excluded from the West Indies team?
Well, I feel very disappointed that a man of the caliber of Shivnarine Chanderpaul was omitted from the West Indies team. You know, Chanderpaul has given over two decades of service to West Indies cricket, and the manner in which I felt he was dropped, you know, was rather unfortunate, a little bit distasteful. And, you know, it begs to wonder if that could happen to Shivnarine Chanderpaul, what about for the other younger guys coming up? What does the future hold for them? You know, that a player of the magnitude of Shivnarine Chanderpaul could be treated like that. Also, I felt if Chanderpaul missing about 80 odd runs to pass Brian Lara, you know, for the most runs in Test cricket history by a West Indian, I felt that maybe the West Indies cricket board, the selectors, they missed out on a great marketing, you know, option there, where, you know, there was a lot to be gained from that publicity wise in terms of the exposure that we would have probably gotten from the international press on, you know, Chanderpaul passing Brian Lara. But nonetheless, I still felt Chanderpaul had a lot to contribute to West Indies cricket. I mean, yes, he went through a bad patch, you know, a few innings averaging about 15 or whatnot. But when you really look at it, the majority of the dismissals were of good deliveries. Some of them were spectacular catches and whatnot. And I just felt, you know, that Chanderpaul, especially in Dominica, will have probably come good at a ground, Winter Park, where he has done very well in the past.
Dominicans have also been pretty upset about the absence of Tyrone Theophile. What is your take on that?
The absence of Tyrone Theophile is another hard blow to stomach here in Dominica. I mean, Theophile was one of the outstanding performers in this season in the WICB Professional 40 tournament. He also had a pretty good season last year. And then to see that guys who were probably, you know, below him were picked, you know, it begs to wonder what really is the criteria to get onto the West Indies team, where you have a guy who was the second leading run scorer in all of the entire tournament, and he's being left out. I mean, it begs to wonder. I mean, if are you saying that the only reason or the criteria was based on the performance in the tour match against Australia? I mean, is it fair to judge a cricketer by this one match as opposed to the contributions he has made throughout the entire season? And I just want to tell Tyrone, you know, to keep it up, keep on batting. Your day will come, your day must come. Just keep on knocking on that door, you will get that chance.
So we're talking with Vinod Mamchan for the Trinidad Guardian. Vinod, your thoughts on Shivnarine Chanderpaul being excluded? Not only being excluded, but do you think the manner was also inappropriate?
Well, you know, being excluded varies one thing, but the manner in which it was done. You know, we need to look at the way the board and players get along and their relationship in moving forward. Recently, there was something in Barbados where the board met with the players, and there was something called WI Up, which was supposed to bring both parties together. At the end of the day, we need to look. We need to understand that we don't have all the answers. We need to look at how we deal with our players. Look at India, how they dealt with Sachin Tendulkar. Could you imagine having the second test match against Australia at Providence in Guyana? That game would have been packed out for every single day. And then the WICB could have actually used that occasion to generate some funds, you know, and gave him a proper send-off. They could have easily printed Shivnarine Chanderpaul jersey, shirts. And I'm sure at 100 US it would have been snapped up. And they could have honored the man. Imagine Chanderpaul walking out in front of the Providence Stadium, packed with people. And that's the kind of thing we need to look at. But in my own opinion, I think he was way past his best. We're looking forward now. And at every juncture, we are going to say that, you know, we tried to remove him too soon, because he would have never been ready, really, to go. You know, I had information. I was in discussion with one of the selectors, and he actually told me that the impression he got from Shiv Chanderpaul was that had he played against Australia and make runs, he would have wanted to continue and go to Sri Lanka.
And that seems to be the big debate. Now, Tyrone Theophile, a lot of Dominicans are upset that he's not playing. Looking at his stats as an opening batsman, he was out, he was overlooked to Chandrika, who didn't play, mind you. But do you think that Theophile has been undone?
I think if you look at the entire setup, and the coach is trying his best to make Sharehope into an opener, I would have probably gone for Tyrone Theophile, because he's an opener, and then use Sharehope in the middle order. We then bring a wicketkeeper batsman, Shane Dorrich, in a position as a batsman now against Australia. And we fit him in the middle order. I think what should have been done, Theophile is an opener. And at the end of the day, Chanderpaul is in the side. He got 72. We can't look to pick a man on one innings. We have to look back at the season. And if they're rewarding men on the season, they must have seen something in him. But the bigger issue to me, though, Barry, is the fact that we can't make Sherhope into an opener. And the coach, Phil Simmons, a former test opener himself, he needs to understand that. You know, he's a middle-order batsman. He's going to deliver in the middle order.
So I'm talking with Carla John-Baptiste. Carla, first of all, how do you feel about the fact that Shivnarine Chanderpaul is not involved in the West Indies team?
Nothing much, per se, in the sense that Chanderpaul did not score runs. I don't think he merited his pick in this test match, because, in fact, if you have to look at it, his only century in the regional competition was in Dominica against the Volcanoes. I felt he struggled, and as such, I felt that he did not merit his pick on the West Indies team this time around.
In terms of Tyrone Theophile, that has always been a hot topic for the last 24-48 hours. Do you think that he should have been playing here for the West Indies, making his debut?
Even more than that, let's go back a little. The West Indies selectors, they selected a 20-man squad to train in Barbados. Theophile was the second highest run scorer in the regional competition. Devon Smith was the first one. Whoever was the first person in terms of wickets, first and second, they were selected on that training squad. Theophile was not selected. I don't understand why. Then you have the West Indies selectors choosing young Hope, who came down the order and put him to open the batting. It's bizarre. Then you have this competition in Dominica, this first test match. Still, there's no Theophile. People are wondering why. And we, as Dominicans, we are thinking that there seems to be real insularity creeping in West Indies cricket. And we're asking ourselves, what game were the selectors looking at? Clive Lloyd? Was he looking at a different game? Was it Marble Hole he was looking at? We seem not to understand, because for the devil of us, we don't understand how has Tyrone Theophile been left out of the West Indies team, given the fact that the criteria for being selected on the team is for you to score runs. He scored runs. He scored over 700 runs, two centuries, a few half centuries, yet he is not on the West Indies team. Something is amiss.
Across the Caribbean, more people are placing their trust in Massey United Insurance for the protection of the things that are important to them, their homes, businesses, and their prized possessions. That's because Massey United Insurance offers excellent general insurance coverage to help you manage whatever life sends your way. Our cadre of well-reputed agencies and trained insurance professionals are always ready to provide you with sound advice and prompt service. Choose the security and sound strength that is Massey United Insurance.
Welcome back to Massey United Insurance's Dine and Life, and we are at the iconic Kensington Oval with the Director of Venue Operations for CPL 15, Paul Skinner. Paul, how are things shaping?
We're going good. Things are progressing nicely. There's a lot of work going on in all the venues. We're shaping up here for the first game in Barbados on June 20th and St. Lucia on June 21st, but we're looking okay.
You're responsible for all the venues, but these are all relatively new venues now, post-World Cup 2007. Not much difficulties in getting them set up for CPL 15, are there?
Nothing that's insurmountable. This is the third tournament we're running, so we are familiar with most of the venues. St. Kitts would have been the second time they're being run this year for CPL. But generally, yeah, we're basically fine-tuning what we've done before and making things better.
Of course, this year we're back with most of the cricket on the lights, and the fans in the Caribbean are responding very positively to that. They plan to go with more TV, with more lights for 2015. A good plan?
Great plan. I think we heard the call last year from our fans, and this year adjustments have been made to the timing. So in all venues, we've have some night games. There's some early afternoon games, 4 o'clock games as well. But as I've traveled around and listened to the fans around, they're extremely happy that we've gone back to night games, and the response at the box venue, the box offices that have opened, has been positive so far.
Well, take us through those box offices. I know that here in Barbados, the box office at Kensington Oval is already open, and I've seen the activity. Tell us about what's happening in the rest of the region.
Well, we have Barbados, St. Lucia, and St. Kitts being the first three venues, effectively, that will get started open at the moment. Tickets are going well. We're happy. Certainly, there's been a great push here in Barbados and an interest in the games, and we've seen that reflected in the sales that we've gotten so far. The box offices in Trinidad and Jamaica and Guyana are going to open towards June 15th, June 18th. There's some cricket going on in test cricket happening in Jamaica, which concludes on the 15th of June. And immediately after that, the box offices for CPL will open.
And of course, as well, moving back to Trinidad and Tobago for the CPL, the finals weekend. We were there for the lineup. Massey United Insurance's Line and Life was there for the CPL 13. And certainly the weekend was a very special one in Trinidad and Tobago. You looking to replicate that in 2015?
Well, plans are underway for that. I don't think things are not finalized with regards to the finals weekend, but we do expect a good show in Trinidad. The interest in Trinidad has been extremely positive. There's been a lot of calls for the tickets, especially for the semis and finals that are going to be held there again. And I have no doubt that the weekend will be another special one in CPL.
We've been able to attract once again some of the iconic players in world cricket, and the fans can expect some activity. Some are close to retirement or have retired, but they're still big names. Shahid Afridi, Mahela Jayawardene. These are the big names in world T20 cricket, aren't they?
Yes, they are. And I think this year, with the change up in the teams, there's going to be some exciting cricket all around. The first game here, Barbados versus the Tridents versus the Amazon Warriors, is going to be a kicker, a repeat of the a rematch of last year's final.
Which ended in some controversy.
Well, yes, it was. But I think that's all now behind us, and folks are focusing on 2015 and what this season will bring. Changes, as I said, across all teams. I think the contests will be easier. You have Jack Callis as well coming for this season. And I think we're in for a cracker of a CPL.
In terms of the volunteer aspect, World Cup 2007 and the ICC T20 in 2010 introduced the concept of volunteers getting involved and assisting for world cricket. That concept reintroduced for CPL 15?
Yeah, we've had it for the previous 2 years, and we will continue with that this year. And we want to give a call out to those who are interested in volunteering in the event to contact your local CPL offices. We are recruiting at some of the venues, but if you're interested in volunteering for the event, it's a good opportunity to come see what CPL is all about. Those who do volunteer find it very worthwhile, and it's one of those concepts within CPL, you think, get everybody involved. And it has a legacy from, as you said, the 2007 World Cup that has continued and worked well for us.
But last night, in fact, I heard about the possibility of Hayley Matthews playing in the Big Bash 2015 in Australia. I know this is a leap away from what we're talking about now, but Paul, any possibility of some of our women cricketers taking part? I know you've introduced cricketers, junior cricketers from the Americas as part of the franchises. Any possibilities of introducing a Hayley Matthews, Stephanie Taylor, DeAndre Dotton to CPL?
Well, I think that's an interesting concept. I haven't heard about the Big Bash introduction here, but I'm happy for Hayley if that does come through, and for the Matthews family in general. I know they've worked very hard. Hayley has been working very hard on her cricket and has done well for the Women's League. CPL is trying to innovate as well as we go through. So these concepts, nothing we have introduced the under-19 players this year. The ICC Americas under-19 players are coming to the tournament. So who knows? Next step, maybe a woman cricketer in each team.
We had heard about the possibility of CPL 15 not being totally within the region, but that concept apparently has gone away for the moment. But is that a long-term plan to move into North America and Canada?
Well, what I'll say is there has been external interest in the tournament. The CPL has grown, and this interest has been seen internationally. So we've been approached by some other entities about the tournament. As far as where that will take us, I'm not sure yet. That's decisions to be made. But for right now, we are here in the Caribbean, 6 venues, looking for a cracker of a 2015 season.
What about fans coming from not only within the region and traveling around via the Latin Caribbean Airlines? Any interest externally, North America, UK, to come down for a weekend or for a 2-week period to watch CPL cricket?
Well, yeah, I know there has been some interest with regards to the finals. Because of our online sales, tickets are available on cplt20.com. And from our online sales, we've seen an interest from parties outside of the region who will be buying tickets to come to the games here in the Caribbean. Like I said, specific interest with regards to the semis and finals in Trinidad, I've personally received. And I'm sure with other games, depending on, you know, who's what teams you're supporting, there will be folks traveling into the region for the games.
At the venues themselves, we've grown accustomed to great excitement. The theme this year, cricket played louder, CPL 2015. Are we going to get that loud noise? Are we going to get the vuvuzelas? What are we going to get?
Well, yeah, that's it. Cricket played louder. You've seen the billboards going up. You've seen, heard the ads.
Big billboards,
you
know, too.
Yeah, some, and you heard the ads on the radio, TV as well during the recent cricket. Yeah, same. We bring about the fun and energy to CPL. Cricket played louder. We hope fans come out. From what all indications are, that it will be out, and I know they're going to be coming with all their tin pots and vuvuzelas.
And you're allowed to bring in anything you want, but within reason.
Within reason, yeah. There are certain terms, limitations with what folks can bring in, and you know, still you need to respect the other fans who will be there. The terms and conditions are going to be available and published online and at the ticket offices when you buy. So there's, you know, there's a list of things you can't do, but that list is fairly finite as far as what we allowed. Basically, cricket played loud. Let's have some fun at CPL this year.
Well, that's it this week for another special edition of Massey United Insurance's Line and Length. I'm Barry Wilkinson in Roseau, Dominica. Thanks so much there to Andrew Seeley and Paul Skinner in Barbados. Of course, next week we'll be coming to you from Kingston, Jamaica, where the West Indies are playing against Australia in the second test. Bye-bye for now.